Good morning. Get everything together here. We had a big evening last night with the children and the children's program, and a lot of visitors and a lot of good time. It's great, but then you have to get everything put back together in the morning, and I'm still getting some of that gathered together. I was going to say a couple of things. By the way, we had a DVD. We did make a DVD of the children's program last night. If you were here and you wanted a copy of it, if you weren't here and you'd like a copy of it, they'll make that available in the bookstore. We did not put it on the internet. We have a bit of a problem with the children. One of the reasons we keep the internet, we keep the camera just on the platform, is that there's always, you know, people always make something evil out of something that's good. And when we, at one point, we took it back so people like to see. You know, I don't know if you know, sometime on Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, people come up here and wave. After the meeting, if you see somebody behind the pulpit waving, they're not waving at you. They're waving at the camera, and there's some of their friends or family that are watching, and they want to say hi to them. And that's fine, because we leave it on a little bit after the meeting for that purpose. But one thing about children is you always have the problem of stalkers and people seeing the kids and that kind of thing. And insurance companies decide they don't want you to, you know, they want to be a little more restrictive about things. So we decided not to put the children's program on the internet. Originally, we were going to just put it on and not tell anybody except, you know, family members. But then if you were watching by the way of internet, you know, last Sunday night, we didn't get on the internet Sunday night until almost the time the meeting was over. That's because we've had some problems with the equipment. The router that we used to connect and so forth blew up last Sunday afternoon, and it wasn't about 5 o'clock when Bob discovered it. He went and tried to fix it and had to finally got it done about 6:30, but our meeting's almost, you know, it's over 7 or 7:15 sometime. But you know how that is. But We did get that back, so we've had some problems. So if you wonder where we were last week when we weren't on, it was because we had some problems that way and so forth. You notice Ms. Costello's over here signing. That camera on the wall there, she's taking a picture of her and sending it out on the internet. And we actually have an internet feed now for if you're hearing impaired, and she's signing the studies. And so forth. She did Alex in the morning, and she's experimenting with doing me if I can talk slow enough that that it works okay. But that's a great thing. Now, if you're on the internet and you're trying to find the feed, you're going to have to call it. You're going to have to email us and get it because it isn't up for the general public yet. We're doing some beta testing. If you right now, you have to have a Linux-based system to get it done. If you don't know what that means you can't do it. Okay, it won't work through Windows and Apple yet, but eventually, once we get it, the bugs worked out of it, we'll have it where it'll do that. So trying to add that, and hopefully eventually be able to add that even to the DVDs when we send them out. But that's a technological problem that is way beyond my pay grade. I pay no attention to any of it until it's done. I learned years ago the best thing to do is for me is to learn to delegate jobs. And I have no problem delegating. I'm not a micromanager. I say, here's what I'd like it to look like at the end. Go thou and do it. And fortunately, we have extremely talented people that take up that challenge and do it. And the folks who work in our media room, Bob, and those guys in there that help him do these things, really get these things accomplished. And I appreciate it, and it's a great thing. And I meet people all around the country that watch on the internet. Brother Alec brought me a thing this morning. It says, there's no hoodly-doo here, and it's a badge that they I'm supposed to wear, because down in Nashville, there are people that watch, and he says they make little things out of the humor that they hear. So evidently, I'm funnier than I think I am. They remember the humor. I'm hoping they remember some of the Bible. Okay? So anyway, that's I say that because it just acknowledges that there are people around that hear those things, and we appreciate that opportunity, and appreciate the interest in the ministry with things like the signing and so forth. I wanted to tell you today so that you know how to plan. We will have services on Wednesday night, Christmas Day, and New Year's Day. Someone asked me about that last week. We don't call off meetings. You remember me saying that 80 or 90 times a year. We do move them sometimes from one place to the other. But I do encourage you. Christmas is a wonderful family time. And I want you to know that we want you to participate with your family and enjoy that. And I would never put an obligation on you to do something that just to be doing it. But for folks that, you know, would like to have something to do that night, my wife is going to go to Mobile that day, so I'll be free. She'd be here if she wasn't going to Mobile. But we will have that Christmas evening and New Year's evening. We'll have a watch night service that 31st, so we'll have two nights that week, but not the Christmas. But I tell you that just because some people had asked me about it and thinking about how to plan their week, okay? Ephesians chapter number 2. All right, Ephesians chapter 2. We're in verse number 8 and 9 today. And I want to just kind of continue what we were talking about last week. I didn't actually get finished with some of the things I wanted to go over with you. Ephesians chapter 2, verse number 8. For by grace you are saved through faith, and that not of yourself. It's a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus, unto good works, which God before ordained that we should walk in them. That's Paul's summary of what he laid out in the first seven verses. That great grace factory that you start in dead in your sins, dominated by Satan, driven by the lust of your flesh, the great enemies of the world, the flesh and the devil, completely captivating you and holding you as your own, but God, who is rich in mercy, verse 4 says, and you always got to be grateful for the but gods in the Bible. But God, when you were lost, thoroughly, completely, and hopelessly lost, desiring to be lost, happy to be lost, while you were yet a sinner, but God commended his love toward us. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love when he loved us. That's that song the girls just sang. He grew the tree that he knew to be the old rugged cross. You know, that's amazing kind of a thing. And that's what, by the way, the real message of the incarnation, the real message of the coming of Christ. If it were not for his coming to become one of us, the Word became flesh and dwell among us. If it weren't for that, the cross work would have been of no value, because the cross work couldn't have been for us, it would have had to have been for him. But because he came in the likeness of sinful flesh, sin apart, but in the likeness of our predicament, in our humanity, came as God incarnate, enfleshed himself in our humanity. That's why the Lord Jesus Christ is, in theology, they have words, the theanthropic person. I love that word. I learned how to pronounce it because I liked it so much. And they call it the hypostatic union. Sort of sounds like something you do at the tire place or something, you know. But what those words mean is that it's something we can't really explain. It's beyond our comprehension. It's something we can believe. We don't have to understand it all. A lot of things you don't understand completely, but that you can believe. But he becomes one of us, and he becomes the one of us so that he can be us in our death and we can be with him in his resurrection life. By grace are you saved. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love when he loved us, even when we were dead in our sins, dead in our trespasses, dead in our rebellion. That's why I'm telling people you need to repent of your sins. That is, be sorry and change your, and decide to quit sinning doesn't save anybody. That's a hopeless, helpless thing to tell a lost man. I mean, think about your life as a believer and how are you doing with that. We all have besetting sins. We all have things that we hang on to. We all have our failures. And to tell someone you have to give up your failures, give up your sins, stop that in order for God to save you, says the cross isn't really the answer. Listen, what you do isn't the answer for your sin. What you do isn't the payment for your sin. What you do doesn't get relief from sin. Only the cross takes care of sin. And so when we were dead in our trespasses and our sins and our rebellion against God, he quickened us. The only answer to death is life. So he gave us life, the thing we couldn't do for ourselves. And then he puts in that little word there in verse 5, by grace you're saved. You see in verse 8 when he repeats, for by grace you're saved through faith, that he adds that for. I want to explain this thing about by grace you're saved, and you get it by faith. He's repeating the by grace you're saved is what you read in verse 4 and 5 and 6 and 7. And he said that salvation that you get because of God's love and his mercy and his grace is yours by faith, not of works. He said it's the gift of God. It's something God purchased and gives to you as a gift free to you, not of works, lest any man should boast. Everything's clear here. Salvation's by grace. It's obtained, received through faith, plus nothing. If you can just put that in your mind, by grace through faith, plus nothing. I ended last week talking to you about the time I was down in a meeting down in Tennessee. And we'd had the meeting. The Bible conference was over at noontime on Sunday. And we went out to a restaurant to eat. And the church crowd came in and was there. And there's a table next to us. And they're all talking about church. And they're having a good time and hooping and hollering and enjoying themselves. And so when we left, I walked over. A couple of us walked over and were talking to them and asked the question, you know, you folks obviously have been at church. Anybody here at this table going to go to heaven when they die? Oh, yes, we're all going to go to heaven when we die. Yes, we've been to church today. We're certainly going to go to heaven when we die. And I asked one, I said, well, how do you know? And they began to go around the table, and finally a lady says, well, Jesus Christ died for my sins on the cross, and I've trusted him. And the question then is that enough? What else? And what you do is you ask that question and shut up. Because if anybody says anything else, they missed it. And somebody said, well, I was baptized. Somebody says, well, and people began, oh, well, I got a better one than that. I do. And pretty soon they're all piping. And finally one guy, he stopped. He says, wait a minute. We're not doing any of that to go to heaven. All we have to do is trust what Jesus did. And he stopped. I thought, okay, got one candidate right here. Because that's the issue. See, people add all kinds of other things, but this verse makes it real clear. It's by grace through faith plus nothing. Now, the reason people get it kind of confused, come back with me to the book of Mark. The reason people get it confused is because it gets confusing when you begin to study the Bible. You know, the old adage about, well, if you read one verse, another one, two verses would be better. Sometimes you can read too many. Mark 16, verse number 15. Here's a verse you hear in missionary conferences all across the world. It's in a passage that is often called in 20th century Christianity the Great Commission. Did you know that nobody ever called this passage the Great Commission before 1850? Well, I'll take it back. One guy did in the 1400s. But nobody went around talking about the Great Commission being the commission for us today until the mid-1800s when a missionary to India developed the terminology in order to raise money for missions. William Carey is where all this stuff comes in our modern missionary, and the reason you see it at mission conferences is because a Baptist missionary to India in the mid-1800s learned that he could guilt trip people into supporting missions by using this terminology. Now, I'm imputing kind of negative motives to him, but I believe that's probably what he did, because that's what you see people do. And now people look down their nose at you and say, you don't believe in missions if you don't believe in the Great Commission. And you know what? That's got nothing to do with the Bible at all. It's got to do with missionaries trying to raise money to do what they want to do. Now, I'm for missions, and we support missions, and we're involved in that. But the point is that a passage like this is used often to tell you this is the sunum bonum of what the church ought to be doing. Verse 15, Mark 16, 15. Jesus says, and he's talking to his disciples, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. We need to go out and preach the gospel everywhere. Amen? Amen. Glory to God. Let's go. But did you read the next verse? He that believeth and is saved should be baptized. That isn't what it said. I was in a meeting one time years ago, and I was teaching, and a guy interrupted me. He says, and he wanted to argue about this passage. And I said, I tell you what, just tell me. I'm going to ask you a question. What must I do to be saved? You just read me verse 50, verse 16. Don't say anything. Just read me the verse. What must I do to be saved? He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. He that believes not shall be damned. If you don't believe, it doesn't matter what you do. But in this verse, believing isn't enough. You got to believe and be baptized to be saved. You go out there and eat a donut off the table out there. Drink a little of that witch's brew they got out there. You know, when Brother Mel died, went to be with the Lord, I thought, well, we'll never find anybody that could make as nasty a coffee as he did. And I'm teasing. I don't drink coffee. That's right. But you know, I think we've succeeded in more than one than in one case. I don't even know who makes it, but they live up to Mel's standard. So you go get that donut, that sweet donut, and then you drink that coffee. And you know, like I said, I'm not a coffee drinker, so all coffee tastes the same to me. It's not appealing unless I put a lot of that creamer in it. If you eat it and digest it, you'll get energy. Okay? If you don't digest it, you don't get the benefit. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. The only way to get the salvation is to believe and to do what believing would do, what that gospel would tell you to do, and that would be the baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. Now that seems pretty clear. But the problem with it, that's not what Ephesians is talking about. Ephesians said, by grace you're saved through faith plus nothing. So here's faith plus something. They're not the same. So what people do, they say, well, what we need to do is change Ephesians and say, well, grace plus something equals grace plus nothing. And you scratch your head and say, no, wait a minute. That doesn't make sense. And you go away thinking, well, you know, the Bible's really hard to understand because they put these two things together and they didn't make sense, but the preacher said they did, and I listened to what he said, and he must be right because, you know, he went to school to get, and pretty soon, nothing. Can you understand why people just throw the Bible away? Turn with me to Acts chapter 2. If you think that's a good verse, how about this one, Acts 2? I just came from down in Tennessee this past week for Brother Ray Watson's funeral. Every corner during the middle of and in the middle of the block between the corners down there are churches called Church of Christ, Campbellites. Church of Christ preachers, teachers, beat denominational preachers over the head with Mark 16, verse 16, because they say you can't be saved unless you believe and are baptized, because that's what Mark 16 says. And if you didn't get it in Mark 16, one of the guys Jesus is talking to, he says this in Acts 2, speaking as the Spirit of God gives him utterance on the day of Pentecost. You know, everybody talks about, whoa, Pentecost, that's the birthday of the church. Well, here's how you get saved at Pentecost, Acts 2, verse 37. When they heard this, they were pricked in their heart, said unto Peter and the rest of the brethren, men and brethren, what should we do? Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ. Why? For the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. So what does a person have to do to have their sins remitted and receive the Holy Spirit? They have to repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. If you repent and be baptized, what happens? Then you can have your sins remitted, and you can receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Now what people do is, by the way, in verse 28 there, 38, they think they can use, you know, that verse will give you a headache. So they said, well, let me put a little ice on that. So they have what they call the ice bag. But it's not ICE, it's EIS. The Greek preposition for the remission of sins there is the little Greek preposition ice. And it means for or because or unto. And they say, well, what that means is you repent and be baptized because you have received the remission of sins. Now, the problem with that is, look at chapter 3, verse 19. You see, the problem when you come up with an idea like that is somebody keeps reading the Bible and run across another verse that kind of trips you up. Acts 3:19, same guy talking. Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out. And notice that next word. When? When are their sins going to be blotted out? The times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord, and he shall send Jesus Christ, which before was preached unto you. When is that? That's the second coming. So when he says, repent and be baptized for the remission of sins, he's not saying repent and be baptized because you have your sins remitted right now. It's so that you can have your sins blotted out when Jesus comes. Now, who's he talking to? Three times in Acts 2, he says, you men of Israel, he's talking to Israel, and the reason they're waiting, the nation Israel is waiting to have their sins blotted out at the second coming of Christ is because that, in Israel's program, is called the Day of Atonement, when God will atone the nation and give them at one atonement, forgive their, blot out their sins. But you try to take that and put that on Ephesians 2, and you say, It makes confusion. It makes contention. It makes an entangled involvement of misunderstanding. But you don't have to go to Ephesians. Come on to Acts chapter 10. The same guy, Peter, in Acts chapter number 10, Pete's out preaching. He goes over to Joppa, takes a little vacation, lays it out on the sun on the top of a house there, and the Lord appears to him and says, Pete, I got somebody I want you to go preach to. I want you to go preach to Cornelius, this Gentile. Pete said, I don't talk to Gentiles. I didn't done that. It's not lawful, not right. I'm a good Israeli. I know what my program is. The Lord said, look, I'm the one who set the program up. You do what I say. Don't argue with me. Pete said, well, you know, who am I to withstand God? I don't understand. I'll do what you said. And he went. And when he went, he started preaching. Verse 34, he said, then Peter opened his mouth and said, of a truth I perceive that God has no respecter of person. You see, I'm getting this. There's something new coming along in Peter's thinking. So Peter preaches to them. Notice what he says in verse 35. Then in every nation, he that feareth God and does what? Works righteousness is accepted of him. Does that sound like Ephesians 2, 8, and 9? Isn't that interesting? Titus 3:5, Paul says, not by works of righteousness which we have done. Pete says, you know what the program back here is? I see that it's not just, it's going to be, anybody in any nation that fears God and works righteousness is accepted of him. And the word which God sent unto the children of Israel, he preached, preaching peace by Jesus Christ, that word you know, word I say you know, which was published throughout Judea and began by from Galilee and after the baptism which John preached, how that God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing and all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. And we are witnesses of all these things both in the land of the Jews and in Jerusalem, whom they slew and hang on a tree. Him God raised up the third day, showed him openly, not to all the people, but unto the witnesses chosen before of God, even to us, who did eat and drink with him after he rose from the dead. And he commanded us to preach unto the people. See, he sent them to preach to Israel, and to testify that it is he which was ordained of God to be the judge of the quick and the dead. To him give all the prophets witness that through his name, whosoever believeth in him shall have remission of sins. And while Peter yet spake these words, the Holy Ghost fell upon him. Now, wait a minute. In Acts 2, how did you get the Holy Spirit? Repent, be baptized, have your sins remitted, and you get the gift of the Holy Ghost. You don't get the Holy Ghost in Acts chapter 2 until you repent, baptize, have your sins remitted, and you receive the Holy Spirit. Okay? Pete's talking along. He's preaching. You got to believe. And bam, the Holy Spirit fell on him. Can you understand why Peter's a bit confused? He goes down to verse number 47. And he says, can any forbid water that these should be baptized? Should not be baptized? Which have received the Holy Ghost as well as us? You know the first person in your Bible that ever, in the New Testament scripture, that ever thought that water baptism might not should be practiced was Peter? It wasn't Paul, it was Peter. Why? Because the whole program's changed. Acts 2:38 isn't in operation anymore in Acts 10. And it's the same dude preaching. And you say, holy moly, this gets... Can you understand why people get confused about this stuff? If you want something even more, come over to Acts 16. Now you come to Paul. Acts 16, verse number 30. The Philippian jailer brought them out and said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? That's sort of like what the guys back in Acts 2 asked Peter, what should we do? And they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved, and thy house. Now, what do you got to do there? Does that sound like Ephesians 2, 8 and 9? What you got to do to be saved? Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. And you can be saved. And so the whole house can be saved too if they want to believe it. Now that sort of sounds like Ephesians 2, 8, and 9. You follow that? But in the book of Acts, you got three different messages. And you say, can you understand why the book of Acts is a little bit confusing to people? It's a transition book. Where you're moving from what begins with God's program for Israel through the 12 apostles to his program for the body of Christ through the ministry of the Apostle Paul. So when you come over to the Ephesians, my point to you is that when you get to Ephesians 2, verse 8 and 9, you don't have that confusion. Everything's clear. Everything is by grace through faith plus nothing. When I was in Tennessee, I heard a guy on the radio preaching, he that endureth to the end shall be saved, Matthew 24, 13. Spent a half hour on the radio talking about how you have to endure. You want to be saved? You got to endure to the end. And I thought, does anybody ever read anything around that? The next verse says that this gospel of the kingdom should be preached in all nations. This gospel of the kingdom. If you don't know the difference between the gospel of the kingdom and the gospel of the grace of God, no wonder you're confused. The same guy would say, no, there's only one gospel in the Bible. Well, you need to back the turnip truck up for the fellow. A guy tells you there's only one gospel in the Bible. Well, down south would say he didn't know the difference between fetch him and come here. You know, sick him and fetch him. Fetch him. Bring it here. Sick him. Go get him. He got no idea what's going on. You come to Ephesians, the confusion is gone. And now it's by grace you're saved through faith. Why? Because you've come to the message God sends to us today through our apostle. If you're going to follow Jesus Christ, you're going to have to follow him the way he designed to be followed in his Bible. Paul says, be followers of me even as I am of Christ. And here it's all by grace through faith. And what grace is all that God's free to do for you through the finished work of Christ. We talked about that last time. Don't forget that. I know people define it in a lot of ways. But if you want the content, you want the doctrine of grace, it's really verse 5, 6, and 7. That's why he repeats that, by grace you're saved. Because he wants you to understand what's going on in verse 8 and 9 is an explanation of what happens to you when you trust verse 5, 6, and 7. When you trust what Jesus Christ has done for you at Calvary. There's a great verse. We're going to study it next week. 2 Corinthians, Paul says, we know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that you through his poverty might be made rich. 2 Corinthians 8, verse 9 says, that's the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. What? It's what God has done for you through him, who was rich in glory, but for your sakes he became poor, that you through his poverty might be made rich. God made him to be sin for us. The one who knew no sin was made our sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Now go back to Ephesians 2, 8. That's why he says, by grace you are saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Notice there are two knots there. And then there's an explanation for each one of them. It's not of yourself. Can you understand today that salvation, the grace of God, is not generated out of inner resources that you have? When you have problems, And you have problems, don't you? When you have difficulties, discouragements, failures, guilt, things that you're trying to do that you can't get done, when sometimes you feel the whole world is falling in around you, people say, look within. Reach in and dig down into the core of you and pull out. And God says, you know, it's not that in where it comes from. Paul says it in Romans 7. He says, you know what I know? That in me, there's no good thing. Now, that doesn't mean there's something not there's nothing valuable in you. It's just that there's, he says, how to will is present. How to perform. I just don't have the resources within me to be perfect, to meet my expectations, much less the expectations of others. And Paul says, salvation for you isn't based upon your ability to meet your or others' expectations. It's not your inner resources. That's why he says, and I love this verse in 1 Corinthians 15, verse number 10. You know, we often quote Galatians 2:20. I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me. Here's the other one of those not I verses. 1 Corinthians 10, verse 15. I'm sorry, 1 Corinthians 15, verse 10. But by the grace of God, by grace you are saved through faith, I am what I am. To me, that's the Popeye verse. I am's what I am's. How? By the grace of God. And his grace which was bestowed upon me was not in vain, but I labored more abundantly than they all. Yet not I, but the grace of God which was with me. You see, when Paul says, it's not I, it's Christ living in me, he's saying, it's not I, but the grace of God. It's all that God can do for me through the person and the work of his Son's life resident in me. It's the Christ life in me. It's the grace life in me that's the issue. And how is that released? By grace through faith. The only response grace will accept is faith. Now, so that you understand completely that it's not your resources that allows you to gain salvation, he says in Ephesians 2, verse 8, not of ourselves, not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. A gift is something outside of you that someone else purchases and gives to you. You don't purchase it. You don't borrow it. Someone else buys it. Acts 20, verse number 28. Take heed therefore unto yourselves and unto all the flock, over which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers, to feed the church of God, which he, God, hath purchased with his, God's own blood. Who purchased you? God did. God was in Christ, reconciling the world himself. Jesus Christ was God at Calvary, dying to pay the purchase price for your soul. That's why he says, don't you know that your body, that you're not your own? You're bought with a price. You see, God bought the gift. Now, what the gift is very important. Look at Romans chapter number 5. Romans 5, verse 15. I'll tell you what, look at Romans chapter 6, verse 23 first. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is what? Eternal life. How? Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Don't forget that verse. What is the gift of God? Eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Come back to chapter 5, verse 15. But not as the offense, so also is the free gift. For if through the offense of one many be dead, much more the grace of God and the gift by grace. You see, if it's grace, it can be a gift. If it's a gift, it has to be grace, which is by one man, Jesus Christ, hath abounded unto many. And not so as by one that sinned, so is the gift. For the judgment is by one to condemnation, but the free gift is of many offenses unto justification. God's going to give you a free gift that Jesus Christ purchased for you. For if by one man's offense death reigned unto by one, much more they which receive abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one. You see what the gift is? The gift is righteousness. And when you have perfect righteousness, the justice of God will therefore give you eternal life. God won't give his life to anyone who doesn't have his righteousness. And when you have his righteousness, then the justice of God will give to you as a gift his life. So he gifts you with his righteousness so that he can grace you with his life. What is the gift of God? It's what God does for you in Christ. It's who he makes you in Christ. It's his life. It's not of yours, it's him. Now, when you get here, you got to understand that Ephesians 2 quits being simple for some people. Because while you read that and you say the gift of God, it's not of works, I'm sorry, by grace you're saved through faith, that not of yourself, it's the gift of God. Not of works, lest any man should boast. Religion comes along and says, well, but what is it that's the gift of God? And philosophical speculation, traveling under the guise of religious theology called Calvinism, covenant theology, reformed theology, all the different terminologies it goes with, says that they tell you that the gift is faith. That what has to give you is not give you his life, not give you his righteousness, but he has to first give you faith, in order for you to believe. And the idea is that the gift of God, well, because you're lost, you can't really believe. So you have to be regenerated, which means you have to have God's life before you can believe. Now, when I say that to you, you look at me like, what was that? That is the common thinking of great portions of Christendom today. Have you ever heard anybody say, I wonder why he chose me to believe and somebody else not to? That's that thinking. He gave you faith, didn't give them faith. Faith isn't a gift. Faith is a choice to believe God's word. In this passage, faith is not the gift. The gift is salvation by grace. The gift is that you can be saved. Now, you can know that for a lot of reasons. The theologians that like to do that, they all love to quote Greek to you, you know. Well, in this verse, they don't ever quote the Greek to you because the Greek teaches that they're wrong, shows they're wrong. When it says, it is the gift of God, that pronoun if there, it there, is you know, you can have a masculine, feminine, or neuter pronoun. That's a neuter pronoun. But the word faith there is feminine. So if you have a neuter pronoun, it wouldn't modify a feminine noun. Because generally speaking, nouns have to agree in number case and gender. So if you were reading the language when Paul wrote it, you wouldn't think it was that. In fact, there's not a neuter word for it to modify in the passage before it, which tells you it isn't one of the words, it's the thought that is modifying. What's the thought? By grace are you saved. Remember verse 5? He's teaching you, for what I said in verse 5 is yours by faith. It, what I taught you in verse 5, 6, and 7, is not of yourselves. It is the gift of God. This great program God's made you of is God's gift to you because of Jesus Christ. But you need to understand, faith is not a gift in the Bible. Never a gift in the Bible. The gift is salvation. John chapter 4, when Jesus talks to the woman at Samaria, he said, I'll give you the gift of, you can have a drink of water that you'll never thirst again. And I'll give it to you. What? I'll give you life. In the Bible, the gift is always salvation. It's always life. It's always the righteousness of God. Come with me, if you will, to 1 Corinthians chapter number 1. One of the things that always helped me in these things is finding verses like this one. 1 Corinthians 1, verse 21. For after that, in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God. I love that. In the wisdom of God, the world by its wisdom couldn't know God. You know how people out there say, I can't find God, don't know God. God fixed it that way. Because until you're going to come to the end of yourself, it's not of yourself. It isn't going to be your wisdom. Now, you know why God fixed it that way? Because if it was your wisdom, what would you do? Boast. I got it and you didn't. That's why that verse says, lest any man should boast. The world, by wisdom, knew not God. It pleased God. You ever heard anybody talk about the sovereignty of God? Sovereign, grace. Those are theological terms. They're not Bible terms. The word sovereign doesn't appear in the Bible. It's a political term, by the way. Kind of redundant anyway. The sovereignty of God. Wouldn't God be the head dude anyway? So yeah, that theology does that. But when they talk about, they talk about the eternal decrees, what God before the foundation of the world determined to do. Here's a verse going to tell you. I don't need to hear about lapsarianism and ultralapsarianism and superlapsarianism and sublapsarianism. I don't need all that stuff. I don't need to have 6 hours of lectures to explain to you what it all is so you can know what it isn't. It pleased God. Here's the sovereign pleasure of Almighty God. To save, it pleased God by the foolishness of preaching. Not foolish preaching, a lot of that in the world, but by the foolishness of preaching. Preaching what? Verse 18, the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness. But that by the foolishness of the preaching of the cross, to save them that believe. So who did God in eternity past choose to save? You see that? Well, that's a pretty simple kind of thing. Come with me to Galatians chapter 3. Galatians chapter 3. Verse number 2. Galatians 3, verse number 2. This only would I learn of you. Received ye the Spirit by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? Well, which is it? By the hearing of faith. Then which came first? The hearing of faith or the Spirit? Hello? Yeah. You see, faith isn't a gift that God gives you so that regeneration, the Spirit, is not a gift that God gives you so then you can believe. You believe so that He then can give you His righteousness, and when He gives you His righteousness, He gives you His Spirit. Look at Ephesians chapter 1. Everybody is so concerned about the order in which things happen. And Paul laid it out for you where you don't have a problem getting it if you just sit and think a minute, sit down, relax, take a deep breath, and look at the process. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13. In whom? And you see the last word in verse 12, talking about the Lord Jesus Christ. In whom ye also trusted after that you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. So when did you trust Christ? after you heard the gospel, that Jesus Christ died for your sins, was buried, and rose again for your justification. You hear the good news of the grace of God, and you respond by trusting it. That's what faith is. It's trusting. It's depending on that exclusively. Now, when you did that, what happened? After that you believed, ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. So when did the Holy Spirit come in and regenerate you and crucify you and indwell you and baptize you and seal you? After you believed the gospel. You heard the gospel, you believed the gospel, you trusted the gospel, you received the gift of God. And that gift of God included God the Holy Spirit coming in and sealing you. Now, when he says the after in those verses, he's not talking about happened here and then 6 months later it happened over there. All this takes place at the moment you trust Christ, but there's an order to it because there is a logic to it. And it's what God provides you in his Son. One other verse. Come back with me to Romans chapter 1, verse 17. And go back in your Old Testament to the book of Habakkuk. Now, you know, you're going to have a little trouble finding Habakkuk, I know. He's not somebody that you read about every day or two. But if you go back and you thumb around in your Old Testament long enough, if you got the right kind of Bibles, page 955, if you find Malachi and just start going to the left, that'll be a shortcut. It's about four books in front of Malachi. Poor Habakkuk gets called a lot of things. Malachi, the guy talked to him one time about Malachi. He said, Malachi, over there in the book of Job. And I figured out who Job was, but who was Malachi? I turned out it was Malachi. So, you know, And you guys just think I slay words and people's names, you know. I'm sorry? Malachi. Yeah. Habakkuk is page 955 if you've got the right kind of Bible. Romans chapter 1, verse 17. Therefore it is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. Now, Paul quotes that passage again in the book of Galatians. It's quoted again in the book of Hebrews. That quote is from the book of Habakkuk, chapter 2, verse number 4. Now, I want you to see how it's a little different back here. Habakkuk 2, verse 4. Behold, his soul, which is lifted up, is not right, upright in him, but the just shall live by, notice, his faith. Not God's faith, his faith. You know where faith comes from? It's your responsibility to believe. And when those verses in Romans say the just shall live by faith, they're not talking about the just are going to live by faith that God implants into them because he chose them before the foundation of the world. He's talking about the just shall live because he's heard the truth of who Jesus Christ is and he's made a choice to depend on him. No gift. If it's a gift, it has to be received. And the hand that receives the gift is faith. And come with me there in Romans. Look at Romans chapter 3. Because what people will tell you immediately is that, well, it's impossible to please God without faith. And we know that they that are in the flesh can't please God. So without faith you can't please God, and you're in the flesh you can't please God. You can't please God. You got to have faith to please God. Then they that are in faith can't please God. Can't have faith because faith pleases God. And you say, huh? I mean, that would mean God's unhappy with people because he didn't give them faith. Then why is he unhappy with them? Because they're right where he chose them to be. I might have to go home and work on that a while. You wonder why people come away with such stupid things that we say. God works in mysterious ways, his wonders to perform. You know why you say that? Because you just got such a screwed up view of what God is, who God is and how he works, that it just doesn't make sense to you. When you take whatever it is you're talking about, lay it on the page of the scripture and find out, you know what, it turns out not to be quite as screwy as you're thinking it is. By grace you're saved through faith, that not of yourself. It isn't your resources, it's God's gift. Salvation is something that God purchased for you and gave to you in Christ. Not of works. We looked at that verse, Romans 11:6 last time. If it's of grace, it's no more works. Otherwise, grace is no more grace. If it's a gift, you don't pay for it. You're coming up on Christmas time. Someone gives you a gift. Do you whip out your pocketbook and say, can I write you a check? You wouldn't do that. Why? It's an insult. What do? You say, thank you. You write them a little note. You say, thank you. You hug their neck and you say, thank you. Because that's all you can do when somebody gives you a gift is accept it. Now, you can reject it and say, nope, I ain't taking that from you. Now, you can do that. Or you can say, thank you, and receive it. But that's really your only options. And when you do that, there's no merit in you in doing that. When people tell you that if you take the provision God has made for you and you make it yours, that then God isn't doing the saving, you're doing the saving. What they're doing is telling you a theological boo-boo. It's called hoodly-doo. And there ain't no hoodly-doo here. There's no merit in believing. The merit is in what you believe. That's why you can believe something sincerely and thoroughly and wholly and be completely wrong. If what you're believing isn't true. If somebody tells you, if you believe, then you've got something to boast in, you read Romans 3:27 to them. Verse 26, he says, to declare, I set this time his righteousness, that he might be just and the justifier of him which believeth in Jesus. When you believe in Jesus, where is the boasting? What does he say? It is excluded. By what law? Of works? No. But by the law of faith. You see, when you follow the works of the law, your performance getting it, there's something to boast about. When you just have faith in something somebody else did for you, there's nothing to boast in that at all. So when preachers tell you that if believing is a requirement for your salvation, then you have something to boast in, the Bible says, no, you don't. No, you don't. Their theology might, but the Bible doesn't. You see, it's by grace through faith, plus nothing. Grace is not a work. I'm sorry, faith is not a work. If you looked at chapter 4 in Romans, verse number 5, we looked at it last time. Romans 4:4, he says, now to him that worketh is the reward not reckoned of grace, but of debt. If you work, it's not grace. But to him that works not, but what? Believes. If you don't work but you believe, then it's believing a work. The answer is no. How do you know? Because I can read what the verse says. And somebody says, well, let's talk about the works of the law. The works of the law are works. Okay? And if it's of works, it's not grace. It's debt. But if you don't work, but you believe on him that justifieth the ungodly, you got to believe the right thing. You got to believe one that can do the job. Your faith is counted for righteousness. You see, the gift is received by faith. Faith is not a gift. Faith is a non-meritorious sense of perception. Faith is being persuaded that what God says is true. And faith is what establishes and makes grace possible. You're there in Romans 4. Look at verse 16. Therefore it is of faith that it might be by grace. You see, the only response grace, the gift, will accept is faith. That's the only response grace can accept, because faith is the only thing you can do without doing anything, because it's trusting what someone else did. It all depends on whether the person you're trusting is worthy. If he can get the job done. That's why it says, but God, who is rich in mercy for his great love, when he loved us. How do you know that his love works? Because when you were dead in sins, he quickened you together with Christ. He puts you in his death. He puts you in his burial. He puts you in his resurrection. He raised you up, and he seated you together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. God has accomplished it for you in his Son. And if his Son can't do it, it won't get done. There's an old preacher's illustration from years ago that I used to hear. Charles Finney, a famous preacher out in Ohio in the 1800s, an evangelist, told a story about a man who had a dream. And a dream was a dream. This is a preacher's story. It's not true, but it serves to illustrate. And he said he dreamed about dying and going to heaven and standing at the gates of heaven, the pearly gates. And a fella came in, comes up to be ushered by the angels up to the gate. And he was a military man with his uniform on, and he had all the regalia of the battles that he'd won, the service that he had done for his company, his country. And he came to the books at the gate, and he said, my name is so-and-so. And they looked through the records, and they could find no record of his name in the book of life. Sorry, you can't enter here. Turned him away, went off to hell. A little while later, he watched another man come, and this man was in business suit, tie. And he talked about how the philanthropy that he'd done, how much money he'd given to feed the poor, how he'd done these things over, but they couldn't find his name in the book of life, and off to hell he went. In a moment, here came a man in a priestly robe with his collar and all of his jewelry and his trinkets, and he talked about how he had done, you know, Hail Mary, fully, all the things that you do in religion, and they couldn't find his name in the book of life and sent him off to hell. And that scene went on and on. And then finally, a little humble woman came up to the gate. And in the story, he said she was a washerwoman. This is a story from the 1800s, and she was just a humble servant, someone who washed clothes for a living. She came to the gate, and she whispered her name. And they looked through the books, and all of a sudden, the gates of heaven just sprung open wide. And the chorus of angels started shouting, and she was ushered in. And as the man stood there listening, he's trying to figure out, how come all these people didn't get in and she did? And so he went over close to the gate and he's listening, and he could hear the little woman singing, his blood is all my plea, hallelujah, for it ransomed me. You know what got her in? It's the blood of Jesus Christ. By grace he is saved, through faith. Not of yourself. It's the gift of God, not of works. It's not resources from within you that you pull out. It's not external religious activities you do on your behalf. It's the gift of God. No boast for you or me. Just confidence in him who's able to do what he's promised us. You know why faith doesn't work? Because it's found a resting place and one that did the work for us. By grace you are saved through faith, that not of yourself. It's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. That's a great message to be studying in Ephesians right before Christmas time. I hope you've trusted him. I look around the auditorium here and I see this great host of people, and I think, wow, I hope every one of you know him for sure. Rely exclusively on him. You're not trusting being here. You're not trusting having a family that does. But you know personally that you've passed from death to life because you personally have made the choice of faith to rely exclusively on the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior. And I trust those of you that have done that, and you know you have, that you walk day by day, and as you've received him, so walk ye in him. Because the Christian life is no more than just living day by day in the reality of who he made you the moment you trusted him. Our Father, we thank you this morning for Jesus Christ. We thank you for the privilege that's ours to trust you and to have your living word live in us and through us for your glory. In Christ's name, amen. We're going to stand and sing number 23, Life Begins at Calvary.
Life begins at Calvary.